Harper Audio presents The Seven by Peter Newman, read by Jot Davies. Chapter 1. Alpha of the Seven stands in an alcove, encased in rock that is eggshell thin. A fragile prison made of grief, of stone tears that flow briefly, hardening, smothering. For 1,000 years, he and his siblings have dwelled in their chamber, wallowing, their gaze turned inward, falling further and further from humanity. It was not always this way. Once, when the breach first stirred, they sent their sister, Gamma, to aid their people. It was her time to shine, to do the Creator's will, and do glorious battle against the infernal. But there was no glory. Only death. When Gamma did not return, the Seven wept anew, a river of tears for the life that should have been. Endless. And when a lowly vagrant returned Gamma's living sword, the relic had changed. They offered it rest at their side, and it rejected them. It judged them. So they retreated from pain and grief, returning to a haven of memories. Years passed, and a new threat arose from the breach. The Seven turned their backs, and Gamma's sword ventured into the world once more. This time a girl bore the sword back to them, and where the man had been silent, she had plenty to say. Alpha remembers her words. They sting and stir, making grief into anger, inaction into action. Rage shakes him. Cracks form in the eggshell-thin layer of stone. Individual chunks fall, like a jigsaw of a man unmaking itself, each piece revealing a glint of silver, a hint at the form that dwells beneath. Wings stretch. A cascade of stone as Alpha steps, shining from the alcove, a halo of flying dust around him. As his essence flares into life, so too do his brothers and sisters. They wake slowly, reluctantly, compelled but hesitant, curious but afraid. Alpha's eyes are the blue of the sky. He looks to each of the alcoves, to his brothers, Beta and Epsilon, and his sisters, Delta, Theta, and Eta. Silvered wings flex, and stone crumbles away, revealing bodies that gleam. The fragments shatter in a cloud. A wingbeat, two, and the cloud is dispelled. They stare at one another for a long time as dust settles and thoughts begin to form. Then, one by one, they step out from their alcoves to join Alpha in the center of the room. Six metal figures, perfect, gather together in a circle. Their voices are music, each weaving with the others, harmonious. Slowly they sing of what has happened while they slept, of all that has gone wrong, and begin to debate what is to be done and how many will have to die. Nearby, Vesper fidgets as feathers are woven into her hair. Is this really necessary? At her question, hands pause, and three sets of eyes flick to the other authority in the room. Overseeing the team of people dressing the girl is Obeisance, the only human allowed within the Seven's inner sanctum. Wrapped in her feathered cloak, her skin is hairless, her toes and fingers without nails, her life and body dedicated to service. Obeisance's voice can soothe immortals. It has no trouble with Vesper. You do not approve.
It's not that, says Vesper. I'm sure it looks lovely, but it's not really me. I think they should see me as I am.
Do you believe you are defined by your appearance?
She scratches at a cluster of tiny white scars on her cheek, thinking.
No.
then appear to them as a leader. You are the chosen of the seven, bearer of Gamma's sword. It will be your voice that leads us into a new age. Change is unsettling, and the people of the Shining City must put their faith in you. This, she gestures to Vesper's outfit, will make it easier for them. Vesper shrugs. Obeisance gives a nod, and the team get back to work. Adjustments are made, tiny details agonized over. Her long coat is carefully arranged, the plates on the shoulders given a final polish. Vesper's boots add an inch to her height, her hair another two. She does not feel any taller.
Are you ready?
Asks Obeisance. She is not. Yes, she replies, lifting the sword and putting it onto her back. Obeisance gives a rare smile.
Good. It is time.
They gather around the steps leading upwards to the Sanctum of the Seven. Thousands of them. A ceremony to welcome the bearer back from her travels. Prominent residents of the Shining City and proud members of the Empire of the Winged Eye. The Seraph Knights in their gleaming armour, the soldiers in their perfect formations, and the citizens, modestly dressed, uniform in appearance and thought. Even the children are here, organised by choir, synchronised and silent. Like a living sea, they swell around the great silver steps, a dazzling monument of seamless metal 50 feet high that ends abrupt in midair. Another 30 feet of empty space separate the steps from the great floating cube that is the sanctum itself, turning slowly, featureless, suspended above by powers no longer understood. A small opening appears at the base of the cube. Two figures framed within. Far below, the assembled crowd lower their heads in reverence and the knights draw their singing swords in salute. One of the figures, Obeisance, steps out, her feet finding purchase in the air, descending, her weight borne by the Seven's love. This is an act of faith she makes daily. The second, Vesper, draws the sword and holds it out. Silver wings unfurl from the hilt, feeling the currents of essence mixed with the air. An eye is revealed set within the crosspiece. It opens and Vesper looks into it. The young woman gives a half-smile and steps out after Obeisance. Neither falls. One walks gracefully. The other with a quiet confidence. When they arrive on the uppermost stair, Vesper frowns. The eye in the sword has not closed. Instead, staring up over her shoulder, it is wide and worried. She risks a glance, but sees only the side of the great cube and the two suns above. Such concerns are soon banished from her mind, for the eyes of the Shining City are upon her. When she speaks, they will listen. And, at her request, every word will be spread throughout the remains of the Empire, via chips whispering into the mind, via runners, traders, and all of the networks at the disposal of the lenses. Her own chip feeds the words of the speech to her now. She knows what to say, but, as Obeisance tells her, only the ear hears the words. It is up to her to win their hearts. She looks for support, a last boost of confidence before beginning. She finds it in a pair of amber eyes watching from several steps down. Her father appears strange, dressed in armour. Even groomed in the style of the city, he stands out, uncomfortable. Despite all the honours, she knows he'd much rather be at home, tending goats and making wonky additions to the house. The thought makes her smile.
She is both surprised and warmed to see him there. Her father smiles back. It is enough. She takes a breath and begins to speak, holding up the sword. Our war with the Infernals has been over for 10 years. The breach remains sealed, but the wounds from those times still linger. For the briefest of moments, she pauses, searching for any kind of reaction. There is none. The South has been ravaged by war. When the demons first came, our people called to the Shining City for aid, and we did nothing. Time and again, they repeated that call. Time and again, we did nothing. Now we have to put that right. Some of our colonies, like Sonorus, felt abandoned by the Empire, and so they left us. And they were right to be angry because we let them down when they needed us the most. We've lost Sonorus now, just as we've lost the Southern Empire. But it isn't too late to form bonds with them again and make amends. They don't need our swords anymore, but they do need our help. You see, the world out there has been forced to change. There are new powers across the sea, human, demon, and half-breed, and wonderful mixes of all three. Some of those powers stood with me against the worst the breach had to offer. She falters, her gaze travelling across the hundreds of staring faces. Only her father's head moves as she speaks, nodding, encouraging. The others, in their multitude, are motionless, their expressions frozen. Do they agree with what she is saying? Do they even understand? We can no longer see the Infernal simply as our enemy. Some are hostile, yes, but not all. And some of them have extended their hands to us in peace. In New Horizon, our people were made into slaves, and it was not the might of the Empire that freed them. It was an Infernal. It was not the Empire that tended their wounds or saw them fed and clothed. It was an Infernal. I'm going to go south again soon to visit our estranged people. But I won't be marching at the head of an army. I'll be going there as a friend. If we want to find our place in the new world, we need to change too. We need to find a new way. To that end, I've arranged a gathering of the greatest leaders of the age. Together we will find a way to live and work alongside each other. Put the past behind us and make a better future for our families and friends. Together. There is no applause when she finishes, no sign from the crowd that they have heard. Her father smiles up at her, eyes scrunched with pride. She wonders whether to go off script, to say more, find some way to reach past the numberless masks, inscrutable, and get a reaction. In her hand, the sword begins to hum. She looks at it. It is looking past her, looking up. So is Obeisance, her father, and the crowd. Twin shadows lengthen, falling across her, making her shiver. Behind her, something moves between her and the sun's red and gold. Something vast. As realization dawns, the assembled drop to their knees, a great wave of dominoes toppling together. Vesper does not need to turn round to know what is happening. She turns anyway. The Sanctum of the Seven, a cube of shining metal 1 mile across, is rising. Turning slowly as it goes, the sanctum blocks out the suns. Everyone watches the ascension, open-mouthed, confounded. A curve of blood-red light peaks from beneath the cube, glimmering. Then a second of gold can be seen. Clouds part long before the cube reaches them, seeming to bend away, reverent. Still higher, the cube floats.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.